Beste vice-rector van Biomedische Wetenschappen, beste secretaris-generaal van het FVO, beste professoren, beste studenten, beste collega's, beste vrienden. Ik ben zeer verheugd om vandaag professor Peter Carmeliet in te leiden als tweede spreker van de toplezingen aan onze universiteit. Today I warmly welcome you at the second top talk of our university. I have the honor to introduce Professor Peter Carmeliet, who is patron of the Vesalius exposition of the M Museum here in Leuven. In fact, Professor Carmeliet does not need an introduction because he is worldwide known for his top-level research in the field of angiogenesis, which is the formation of blood vessels. Nevertheless, I would like to summarize a few highlights in his career that you may not be aware of. After his studies in medicine, Peter doubted about his future. He doubted about becoming either a scientist, an engineer, or a professional musician. Luckily for science and fortunate for our university, Peter decided to become a scientist. He started his career in the laboratory of Professor Desiree Collin, and soon he became the director of the Vesalius Research Center. Peter has an H-index of 108, which is an indicator of top-level research. He has published over 550 research papers, a lot of them in top journals such as Science and Nature. He is the most cited Belgian scientist in the field of biomedical sciences. And around the world, he has given around 360 invited lectures. Next to this, he is editor of Science and Cancer Cell. And he has also several research grants of the IWT, the FWO, and top grants, including the Methusalem and an ERC advanced grant. He has been awarded several prestigious prizes, including the Interbrew Bayet Latour Prize, the Ernst Young Medical Award, and the Franky Prize, among others. He is also a member of the German Academy of Sciences, and he has an honorary doctorate of the University of Frankfurt. In sum, we can say that Peter Carmeliet is a world authority in the field, a trendsetter, and an example to many scientists and students. And we are very happy that he is here now as our speaker of the second top talk this year. And I am very confident that you will enjoy this talk, which is entitled Breaking Boundaries. Peter, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Vice-Rector and Mr. Vice-Rector, for the invitation to speak here today in a series of top talks. I'm really humbled by the honor. What I would like to do today is actually to dissect the legacy of Vesalius. And what I would like to answer is two questions. How did Vesalius break boundaries, and which type of boundaries did we in our personal work have to break? And humbleness commands me to stress that, in all honesty, the type of boundaries that Vesalius has broken 500 years ago are of a completely different magnitude and grandeur, obviously, than the ones that we try to break today. Vivitur ingenio, caeteris mortis erunt. Only what is genial lives on, all the rest is mortal. These were the words of a man who lived 500 years ago, of a great man, a genius, the man who broke boundaries, exceeded limits, overthrew dogmas, and changed the face of medicine forever. This was Andreas Vesalius. He is, and he likely will remain, the biggest or the largest scientist for Belgium ever. And he clearly belongs to the absolute top of giants like Da Vinci, Copernicus, Newton, Einstein, and others. Andreas was born as Andries van Wezel in Brussels on the eve of New Year's Eve in the year 1514. in a family of medical doctors. His father, his grandfather, and his great-grandfather were all medical doctors, some in service of the royal court. And what is striking that already from an early age onwards, Andreas was fascinated by biology, anatomy, and started to do dissections on small animals. At the age of 15 years, he moves to Leuven to study at the university. And he first obtains a broad humanistic training at the famous Trilingue College in Leuven, where he studies Greek, Latin, rhetoric, logic, and philosophy. Now, since it's a presentation of breaking boundaries, I'm going to dissect with you how actually Vesalius was able to break these boundaries and what type of gifts and talents he had. And the first is clearly Vesalius was intelligent. He spoke fluently Greek, Latin, even Hebrew. He was ambitious and he wanted to become a medical doctor like his father and forefathers. And he was certainly not narrow-minded, but he had an open mind for the unknown. After 3 years, Vesalius decides to enroll at the Sorbonne University in Paris to study medicine. Now, you have to realize that the anatomy professors at those times were actually teaching their students by reciting the work of classics without questioning its correctness. And they never performed dissections because they considered this as barbaric. And they left this to the barber surgeons, but they dissected not humans, but actually animals. And this is going to be important for the talk later on. Now, the standard reference work that was taught at that time was that of Claudius Galenus. Galenus was a Greek born in Pergamon in the year 131, and he became a doctor of initially of gladiators and later of Roman emperors, and he dominated really medicine for more than 13 centuries. He published more than 500 books, many of which about medical anatomy, but since dissections of humans were banned in the antique Rome, Galenus used animals for his dissections, such as pigs and monkeys and dogs. Now, it was very clear at that time in the 16th century that the 13-year-old wisdom could absolutely not be questioned, and certainly not by 18-year-old students. And so if a surgeon noticed a difference in the anatomy with Galenus' work, then it was clearly his fault, not that of Galenus. But Vesalius is suspicious and becomes critical and wants to see the anatomy of the human body with his own eyes. And he starts to criticize his peers and must have said, from their high chairs, they rattle as crows about things they have never seen themselves. So, in his free time as a student of 18 years old, Vesalius digs up skeletons and corpses from the cemeteries of Paris to perform anatomical dissections. And it is here that he discovers that Galenus has made several errors. Indeed, he discovers that the human jaw is actually one bone and not two, as it is the case in certain animals, as was published by Galenus. And so here you recognize the talents of Vesalius. Vesalius was scientifically curious and also meticulous because he must have said, I don't speak about things that I have not seen myself twice. He was also critical and believed only what he had seen himself. And he had overall enormous guts, if I can say so, to challenge ancient dogmas. And this was at the time really revolutionary. He also revolutionizes the way anatomy was studied at the time. He starts to dissect healthy subjects because he believes that we first need to understand how the healthy body works before you can analyze disease. And second, he also starts to study systems, a system of the blood vessels, or of the nervous system, or of the muscles. And he views at the body in an integrated fashion, thereby breaking with the tradition of his previous ancestors. And here you see again another talent of Vesalius. He was highly creative and visionary at the time. But then he has to return to Leuven because a war breaks out, and he starts to steal carcasses of hanged prisoners, like a thief in the night. And he does that from the Hill of the Gallows in Leuven, which is presumably the Gasthuisberg. And he performs anatomical dissections in part in the anatomy amphitheater in Leuven. To do that, I think you will agree with me that Vesalius was courageous and fearless, that he was extremely self-confident and scientifically stubborn, and all alone, you must realize, he went against the mainstream and he was only 20 years old. But then at that stage, actually, the University of Leuven was not so enthusiastic about his dissections, and after a quarrel with his mentor, he actually leaves to Padua, to Italy. And it is here that he can do more freely do dissections, and he does that in the anatomy theater, where he then stands in the center dissecting the corpses and with the students and the public on the balconies. And at the age of 23, he graduates as a doctor in medicine, and strikingly, the next day already, he's appointed professor of surgeon by the students, because at that time, it was customed that the students would elect actually their professors. Now, these dissections were really a spectacle, well attended by not only medical doctors or students, but also by the citizens of Padua. And they usually occurred in the winter time, because of obvious reasons, because in the summertime, the decomposing bodies would smell too much. And they usually occurred during 3 days. The first one to dissect the belly or the abdomen, the second the chest, and the third one the brain and the muscles and the rest. And Vesalius became very famous for his dissections and discoveries. Now, he was also technically very gifted and must have been extremely motivated and passionate, because at a certain time, Vesalius is struck by disaster and even accused of murder because he's dissecting a high-ranked citizen while his heart was still beating. And even the king had to intervene. And despite a nearly executed death sentence, Vesalius continues his experiments. So these are really signs of that he's not only handy and proficient, but that he has a high frustration tolerance, an extreme motivation and passion, and he's persistent despite misfortune and bad luck. He continues to gather a lot of information, and at the age of 28, he decides to publish his book, De Humanu Corporis Fabrica, about the architecture, about the structure of the human body. 7 atlases, 636 pages long, full of anatomy, and he paid it using his own funds. You will agree with me that he must have been very efficient, well-organized, hardworking, and perseverant. But what is very clear from then onwards is that Vesalius has changed medicine forever. From now on, there was a time before Vesalius and a time after Vesalius. Here you see some examples of these illustrations in his book. And you will agree with me, what is really striking is the type of precision and the sense for detail. Also, most of his findings are actually still correct today, except for the throat, his notes on the throat, because you can imagine that he was using corpses for people who were hanged, and that explains then the unclarities. He made several corrections, over 200 of what Galenus had reported, and made a number of important new discoveries as well. But what is really striking with these images is that actually his corpus seemed to be alive. And these images are really panoramic views of the surroundings of Padua in which the corpus seemed to be walking around. Such an artistic representation of scientific findings was revolutionary, simply genial. So Vesalius was visionary and had an enormous didactic talent, and he understood very well the power of communication to convey a key message and convince his audience. Now, it was actually Leonardo da Vinci who pioneered dissections first on humans, but Leonardo did actually fail to publish his work, and it became buried in the cellars of the Vatican and only discovered many years later. And so here you see also that Vesalius fulfilled the criterion of a top scientist to be the first to publish, still a criterion today. And this was in a time when there was no pressure at all to publish or to perish. He was also not the first to overthrow dogmas from classical antiquity, because Nicolaus Copernicus, just 1 week earlier before his publication of his famous books, published his book, De Revolutionibus Orbium Celestum, in which he actually argues that the sun and not the earth is at the center of the universe. But together, these two alumni of Padua actually really created a scientific revolution in the world. So if we dissect Vesalius' geniality, then we have to conclude that it is not due to a single reason, but due to a unique combination of gifts and talents. He was intelligent, ambitious, curious, creative, visionary. He was efficient, well-organized, technically gifted, courageous, and perseverant. Critical, scientifically stubborn, extremely self-confident, frustration-tolerant, but above all, he must have been extremely motivated and passionate. So how does all of this actually link to the work that we do at the Vesalius Research Center? Well, Vesalius' work on blood vessels is considered to be his greatest discovery and contribution to medicine. And we work on blood vessels. Now, what are blood vessels actually? Why did they develop? What is their function? Blood vessels supply oxygen to all cells in distant organs. And every cell needs oxygen to function and to survive. So when did, in evolution, did blood vessels develop? Well, here you see a flatworm, a very primitive organ, and they are so thin that oxygen diffuses to all inner cells, explaining why they actually don't need any blood vessels. And the same is true for fruit flies, where a branching network of airways throughout the body delivers oxygen to all cells. But higher organisms developed blood vessels to transport oxygen, since oxygen could no longer diffuse to all distant cells. And here you see an example of blood vessels in the brain. And if you would lay out all the blood vessels in your body in an adult organism in one line, this line would be more than 160,000 kilometers long, which is four times the circumference of the Earth. Now, the cells that line the blood vessels are called endothelial cells. Our body contains 6 × 10²⁷ endothelial cells, or more than a billion times a billion. In total, they weigh over 1.5 kilograms, that's more than an adult heart, and they cover more than 1,000 square meters, which is larger than an Olympic swimming pool. And in a healthy adult, they're usually at rest, but in disease, they can start to grow very rapidly. Now, who discovered actually the blood vascular network? Well, it was Marcello Malpighi in the 17th century who discovers that there is an artery coming from the heart. This is the chicken embryo, this is the head. An artery pumps the blood from the heart and delivers it and branches it into the capillaries, the small vessels that you see here, which is then drained by the veins that return the blood to the heart again. And if you look at this network in this image, then it's really like how Aristotle actually phrased it. The blood vessel network resembles the irrigation network in a garden. They start from one source and branch into progressively smaller branches so that every corner of the garden receives water. It was Leonardo da Vinci who discovers that blood vessels can grow, a process that we now call angiogenesis, as you can see here in the lung of an injured soldier. But now we know, unfortunately, that vessels, there are not only vessels of life, but also of death. And in fact, there are more than 70 diseases that result from either insufficient or an excess of angiogenesis. The insufficient angiogenesis results to the ischemic diseases in the heart and the brain, but can also lead to baldness or loss of hair. Whereas an excess of angiogenesis results in the formation of or the progression of cancer, but also of blindness, as well as of inflammatory disease, and perhaps also obesity. Now, when dissecting the arteries and the veins and the capillaries, Andreas Vesalius actually discovers the neurovascular link when he integrates both the vascular and the nervous system together. And he notices that there are several parallelisms between both systems. And indeed, like the medical students now learn in their textbooks, the yellow nerves run along the blue veins and the red arteries. Now, there are also other similarities because both vessels and nerves are delivery channels. Vessels deliver oxygen, nerves deliver electrical impulses. And it is the Vesalius Research Center which studies the molecular basis of the neurovascular link in greater detail. Now let's have a look at what signals actually determine angiogenesis. But before doing so, I need to show you one of the first three movies on how vessels normally form. And I hope it works because there was already one other movie that didn't play. No, this is Lynn. It works? Yeah. So what you see here is the endothelial cells of a vessel, and those are the support cells, and we call those the pericytes. And when there is a hypoxia shortage of oxygen, then signals like VEGF, we'll talk about that, induce this, the or stimulate the induction of what we call a tip cell. This is the cell at the forefront of the vessel sprout, and it has these finger-like protrusions, which we call filopodia, which actually sense the neighborhood for signals like VEGF. Then at the back, we have the stalk cells, and those are the cells that are proliferating and actually elongate the stalk. When two neighboring sprouts meet each other, they will fuse together, and then the vessel will become perfused. And once that happens, then you see changes happening, such as there's more matrix, more of these support cells, more junctions between the endothelial cells, and that will then mature the vessel, and that is necessary for an optimal function. Now, this process is actually very dynamic, because you will see in a second that actually this tip cell becomes tired and maybe perhaps metabolically exhausted, and then another stalk cell takes over. This stalk cell is then more fitter and actually secures that the vessels keep branching in the optimal manner. Now, there is one particular growth factor called vascular endothelial growth factor, VEGF, which is absolutely the most important angiogenic factor. And this is actually already occurring in very primitive animal species, and that usually tells you that it is an important signal. Because here you can see in the marine jellyfish that VEGF regulates already the formation of the most primitive gastrovascular tubular system. So how does VEGF work? VEGF is a soluble agent that is circulating in the blood and can stimulate the endothelial cells. And it does so via activation receptors, those are sort of receiver molecules or proteins on the cell surface of the endothelial cells. And this is what you see here. Here is the cell surface of the endothelial cell. These are the receptors or the receiver molecules, and that is VEGF. And once they bind together, they activate it and they introduce and induce a lot of cellular changes inside in the endothelial cells so that the vessels start to sprout. Now, in order to study the role of VEGF in vivo, we made some knockout mice that were lacking VEGF. And what you see here is a healthy embryo, very early in development. This is a section through the head. This is the heart. And what is important for this presentation, that everything that is blue here are blood vessels. And you can clearly see many patent perfused blood vessels. Now, if you analyze then an embryo of VEGF knockout mice, where only 50% of the normal VEGF levels are present, you don't find any blood vessels anymore. So the finding that only 50% less of a protein resulted in such a severe defect was unprecedented at the time and demonstrated truly how important VEGF was. Now, to achieve this goal, we had to break some boundaries ourselves. And I'm going to share some of our experience and frustrations and challenges with you without, however, pretending that our boundaries can equal those of Vesalius by far. First, I actually made a decision to make a knockout of VEGF when I just returned from the postdoc at the Whitehead Institute in Boston. But I actually was changing fields and did not know anything about angiogenesis at all. In addition, I knew that there was strong competition from Genentech, and they had started already with the project more than 1 year ahead. In addition, no one at the KU Leuven mouse service facilities had heard of a transgenic mice. So together with Jeff Arnout, I had to spend 50% of my time designing plans for the animal facility, not being able to spend time on this project, that turns out to be extremely technically challenging and for which I had to go and spend several months in Toronto. But then we succeeded finally. We published the first knockout mouse in Belgium, the first knockout mouse in the angiogenesis field, and provided evidence that VEGF was very critical for angiogenesis. This evidence actually formed the basis for the development of anti-VEGF therapy for cancer and ocular blindness. This paper is now cited more than 2,500 times, and it really turned out to be a milestone change in my career. So aiming high and taking high risks seemed to pay off. That was the first lesson I learned. But what happens actually in tumors? When a tumor starts to grow, initially there are only a few cells and they don't need any blood vessels. But when the tumor starts to grow to a size that is larger than 1 cubic millimeter, it needs food and oxygen and nutrients. And it will stimulate then the production of signals that will then induce the formation of new blood vessels. And that is called the angiogenic switch. And it is by far very clear that VEGF is the most important factor controlling the angiogenic switch. Just for your illustration, there are more than 50,000 publications on this molecule alone. But VEGF is not only important for the primary tumor, it also kills patients because it stimulates the dissemination of cancer cells. The tumors not only produce angiogenic factors to supply or to receive more blood and nutrients, but they also hijack these blood vessels and actually escape via these vascular routes, as you can see here, to distant organs where they start to metastasize. And this is really what is killing more than 90% of our patients. So the concept of anti-VEGF therapy was actually rather simple. VEGF is the most important factor for the angiogenic switch. Fine, let's turn off VEGF so that we can starve the tumor to death by blocking its blood supply. Now, anti-VEGF therapy has been used already to treat more than hundreds of thousands of cancer patients and has a sales revenue income of more than $8 billion per year. But there are also some challenges and problems with it. For instance, since VEGF is essential for angiogenesis during growth, blocking VEGF in children with cancer is absolutely not a therapeutic option. So we focused on PLGF, a sister molecule of VEGF, but the problem was that that molecule was actually dead. It was completely forgotten and overlooked. No one believed that it had any function at all. But we thought that Mother Nature actually, if it would create a molecule like PLGF, that it would also have some function, and so that we had to look harder. So we created a mouse lacking PLGF, and we found that PLGF is only essential for angiogenesis in disease, but not in normal health. And that, to us, makes PLGF very attractive for anti-angiogenic therapy. So we then later found that blocking PLGF inhibits the growth of medulloblastoma, which is actually the most frequent brain tumor in young children with little treatment options. And it's a tumor that develops in the back of the brain, in the small brains, as you can see on the pictures. And we are currently actually developing anti-PLGF antibodies for therapy of children with brain tumors by using PLGF antibodies which capture and neutralize PLGF. And this is shown on the next movie. So what you see here is like VEGF, PLGF also binds to these receiver molecules on the cell surface of the blood vessels, the receptors, and that will trigger the formation of angiogenesis and new blood vessels. So when you give them an antibody, this is a protein that actually captures PLGF, PLGF will no longer be able to bind to these receptors on the endothelial cells, and no new blood vessels can be formed anymore. Even more, the blood vessels will start to retract, and that will also lead to a reduction in tumor growth. So this was, again, breaking boundaries. PLGF was believed to have no role in angiogenesis. This was forgotten as a dead molecule, but we persisted and actually show that PLGF was only affecting angiogenesis in disease and not in health. And it improved, inhibiting PLGF improved the outcome of pediatric brain tumors in mice. And now we're starting up a biotech company together with VIB to develop anti-PLGF for children with this brain tumor. So the second lesson I learned, rowing against the stream and believing in a dead molecule paid off. But tumor vessels pose a larger threat than what I just explained you. What you see here is in how vessels are structured in a normal healthy tissue. You have an artery branching into capillaries and then drained by the veins. And this is nicely organized and hierarchically structured. What happens in a tumor is completely chaotic. The vessels are disorganized in structure and in function. They're tortuous, they're serpentine. In some locations, you don't have any vessels. In others, you have very large vessels. And if I would show you how the flow of the blood will flow, then you will see that the blood will flow in one direction, then stop at a certain moment, and even be reversed. So chaotic is the tumor vessel vasculature. And I want to stress this even more, by showing you how a normal healthy vessel looks like when we look inside into the vessel. And you see here all the individual endothelial cells, and you see how nicely and smoothly the surfaces of this blood vessel inside, which optimizes perfusion. And if you compare that to what happens in a tumor, then what you see here are the cancer cells, and these are the endothelial cells. They're crawling over each other, they're hyperactive, they're migrating everywhere. You will agree with me that this actually impairs rather than improves perfusion. And so what happens is that because of the hyperperfusion, there's a shortage of oxygen and nutrients inside in the cancer. And that has important consequences because now the cancer cells are no longer happy, and this creates a hostile microenvironment from where the cancer cells even try to escape. And that explains why actually there is more metastasis, more dissemination of the cancer cells. But at the same time, to make it even worse, what also happens is now that the cytosteric, the chemotherapy, cannot be perfused and delivered to the cancer cells anymore. So there is poor drug delivery. And because chemotherapy actually requires oxygen to be converted to oxygen radicals to become active, since there is less oxygen in the tumors, abnormal tumor vessels also impair that process. So this is shown in the next movie here, where you see here the cancer, which releases a lot of VEGF and other angiogenic agents, and that causes the formation of an excess of new blood vessel sprout, but you already immediately see that these vessels are very abnormal in shape and in structure, and they're full of holes and they're very leaky. Because there is an excess of VEGF and other angiogenic signals, there are too many of these vessel sprouts and they become completely disorganized. And as you will see in a second, because there are holes in these in the vessel walls, red blood cells will escape through it and leak into the tumor, and that will cause tumor bleeding. That is okay, but what is worse is that now also cancer cells use these holes actually as gateways to escape from the tumor, from that toxic microenvironment that is hostile, and they escape to distant tissues, like for instance here in the liver, where they will form metastasis and ultimately kill the patient. So we're currently in the angiogenesis field facing a dilemma. How should we treat our cancer patients? Should we prune the vessels? Should we destroy them? Or should we normalize the vessels? Let me explain you this. So this is a situation in the tumor. So in the traditional current way of thinking, what now happens is that vessels are pruned, they're destroyed with anti-VEGF therapy. But that bears the risk that actually you will destroy too many vessels, and there is no way actually anymore to supply oxygen and nutrients. So you create actually an even further toxic and hostile microenvironment whereby the cancer cells become more malignant, they become more invasive, they try to escape from the tumor, they're all more metastatic, and they respond worse to chemo radiation. This is a traditional way of thinking. An alternative, more novel approach is vessel normalization, whereby we try to heal the tumor vessels, whereby we try to increase perfusion so that the cancer cells are more happy in an environment where there is food and oxygen. These cancer cells are more benign, they're more encapsulated because they don't invade, so they're easier to surgically dissect, they metastasize less, and also they respond better to chemoradiation therapy. The problem only is there are no clinically approved efficacious tumor vessel normalization drugs. So together with Patricia Augustinus in a collaboration, we focused on a molecule called chloroquine, which is in fact an old drug used to treat malaria, and it had unexpected effects on tumor blood vessels. Indeed, we found that chloroquine actually induces or normalizes, heals these abnormal tumor vessels into more and better perfused vessels, which reduced and also metastasis and improved chemotherapy. So to stress this point a little bit further, in the leaky abnormal vessels, there are holes and tumor cells can escape and invade and metastasize. But when you heal the vessels with chloroquine, you actually made the barrier so tight that cancer cells can no longer use these holes in the blood vessel wall to escape and to metastasize. And so this is shown in the next movie here, whereby we now have treated the tumors with the drug chloroquine, and you see that the vessels are still forming, but they're more normal. They don't have all these holes, and we call these cells even phalanx cells. They have more of the matrix, they have more junctions, they're just tighter, they also have more of these support cells, which all make the, cell, the vessels actually more mature and more stable. And importantly, it will also improve the perfusion of these vessels. And this is entirely different from what you see in the abnormal tumor vessels, where cancer cells escape via these gateways to metastasize and kill patients. In addition, so perfusion is also improved. And as you will see in a second, the yellowish stuff that is floating around here, that's the chemotherapy, will reach now better the cancer cells and also will be able to better kill the cancer cells. Now, an important question after what I told you all is, does actually anti-VEGF work in the clinic at all? Well, when cancer patients become diagnosed with cancer, they usually get a treatment in order to slow down the progression of the cancer. But after a while, in many cases, in many patients, the cancer will start to regrow. So if you treat these patients with anti-VEGF, then you see that you actually prolong that time that they before the cancer regrows. But what is important, however, is that you look at the overall survival effect of anti-VEGF treatment, then you see that we have lost that benefit, and that is a great problem. And that we know now is due to resistance. The tumor cells become smart enough. And one of the mechanisms of resistance against VEGF, anti-VEGF therapy is shown on the next slide. So here you have an endothelial cell. You activate, stimulate with VEGF on the receptors. That induces angiogenesis. You block VEGF, you block angiogenesis. It's as simple as that, but not in a human cancer, because in a human cancer, the cancer cells will start to produce other angiogenic factors, such as FGF, that will actually escape vascularization of the tumors. And so you can continue to keep on going with that strategy. You can block FGF, you can block the next one and the next one. So we thought some 5-6 years ago that it was time for a change and that we needed to reconsider this fundamentally. And we considered to actually block the very heart, or the heart of the endothelial cell, the engine that drives the endothelial cell, and we considered that this was metabolism onto which all these angiogenic signals converge. So the idea was, let's block the engine, metabolism, rather than the drivers, VEGF, FGFs, and the other. And so to stress this new concept a little bit further, I showed you this here in a very simplified scheme. So in the traditional concept, you have a driver, which is then the angiogenic signal, VEGF, and you have a car, that's the endothelial cell. So as long as you have a driver, the car will ride. If you block that or you move the driver, then there is no riding anymore. But if you find another driver, then the car will start to ride again. And this is precisely what is happening with anti-VEGF. You block VEGF, but there is another guy coming up, stimulating angiogenesis. With the new concept that we had proposed, we would block the engine of the car, and the car would no longer be able to ride, despite the fact, or regardless of the fact, that there are many drivers standing by. And for us, the engine is metabolism. But what is metabolism? Well, metabolism is a complex process that in all essence actually converts food into energy and building blocks. So you convert food, and in a process called catabolism, you generate energy that you need for contraction and for movement, and into cellular building blocks that in a pathway called anabolism is then used to synthesize new macromolecules such as proteins and DNA. So a cell uses oxygen, lipids or fat, proteins and sugars, and other nutrients to actually metabolize or convert it into energy and biomass. And this occurs via a very complex process of more than 3,000 metabolic pathways and more than 8,000 metabolites. Now, we chose to select and study one particular process, which is called glycolysis. And glycolysis stems from the Greek name glucose leucis, which is the same as splitting sweet, splitting sugar. And in the chemical reaction that I'm going to spare you, you can actually find that if you split the molecule glucose, which is a sort of sugar, and you split it into two molecules, that you actually liberate ATP, which is energy, which the endothelial cells need to proliferate and to migrate. Now, it turns out that endothelial cells in blood vessels are actually extremely glycolysis addicted. So we thought, well, maybe this is a good target. So we made mice lacking this particular glycolytic activator in endothelial cells. Now, if you compare here, first the vascular retinal network in a healthy mouse, and if you compare that to the one where we impaired sugar uses and utilization, then you will clearly appreciate that there are severe vascular defects. Also, if we do the same experiment in a fish and we block sugar utilization in the endothelial cells, then that causes severe vascular defects. Here you have a movie showing how these vessels form real life in a healthy fish, and you will see that that is very efficient, but if you block then sugar use and metabolism, you see that that process occurs much more, much less, and also not as efficiently. So endothelial cells, and this is an endothelial tip cell in particular, take up a lot of glucose and then metabolize it to generate large amounts of ATP. More than 85% of their ATP is generated via glycolysis. If they want to move, they even further increase glycolysis so that there is more energy available for the cell to move. And so when a cell is overtaken by, a tip cell overtaken by a new stalk cell, then that stalk cell actually needs even higher levels of glycolysis so that it can be more efficient and compete for the tip cell. And when we block then also glycolysis, then we also see that actually migration of that tip cell is blocked and impaired. But are there any therapeutic implications of all these findings? Well, we focused on a disease called age-related macular degeneration because it is the leading cause of blindness in the elderly. And if you would have the disease, if you suffer from the disease AMD, then your vision would be blurred as such. And the reason for that is that in the back of our eye, there are vessels that in AMD patients actually overgrow in massive amounts, in excessive amounts. So we showed in mice experiments that when you block sugar metabolism, that you can convert this situation of overgrowth to a more normal vascular situation. And so we hope and we will explore in the future whether such blockers of sugar metabolism might actually be useful to treat also AMD patients. So this was talking about breaking boundaries 3. When we started this study, there was not a single study on endothelial metabolism and angiogenesis. We had no funding for this project, no support, no expertise, and what even was worse, I had no or almost no interest PhD students or postdocs who were interested in this project because they all thought that there was now had become completely nuts by moving to such a field which was so distant away from angiogenesis. And it was really like this. This was the type of feeling that I had at the time. But while this mission seemed impossible, I nevertheless decided that it was not necessarily undoable. And so I invested royalty returns in metabolomics facility. I preached metabolism in an angiogenesis lab. The first paper took more than 5 years and was rejected. It took more than a year to revise the paper. But ultimately, it was the first paper on endothelial metabolism and angiogenesis. And we started a new field with multiple novel therapeutic opportunities to block angiogenesis in disease. So the third lesson, diving into new territory, paid off. Let me then finalize by actually talking to you about how vascular signals can also be important for the nervous system. And this project started in a very serendipitous way. And we asked the question, does insufficient VEGF-driven angiogenesis result in oxygen shortage in the heart so that it could actually lead to, for instance, a heart attack? And we therefore made transgenic knock-in mice, which had only 25% lower levels of VEGF, using a novel genetic technique that no one else had used at the time. But surprise, surprise, what we found was that mice with these subtle low reductions of levels of VEGF actually did not die of myocardial ischemia or heart attacks, but actually showed this very weird behavior when you pick them up from the tail. A healthy wild-type mouse, a control mouse, will try to escape and be vigorous and move around. But this poor guy actually went into a cramp, and as you will see also, it did not take care of his fur. And that is because mice lick their fur, but these mice were actually paralyzed and could not do so. Also, when you turn a mouse on its back, a healthy mouse will actually flip over, and the more you do it, the faster it will do it, and you can do it even 300-400 times. But mice with low VEGF levels actually are completely exhausted and tired after 50 to 60 times. So we gradually started to realize that what we had actually achieved was that mild reduction in VEGF levels causes muscle paralysis, as occurs also in amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, a disease called ALS. And we generated also ALS mice with low VEGF levels, and we tested them in a rotor rod. And so this is a turning wheel, and if the mice wants to stay on the, or the mouse wants to stay on that wheel, it has to walk. And so what you will see is that the ALS mouse with low VEGF levels will actually do that for a while, but then actually fail and fall off. Now, I showed you already that for the muscle actually to move, nerve cells need to deliver electrical impulses to the muscle, as you can see here. And this is precisely what is going wrong in ALS. So the nerves, the motor nerves in our spinal cord that control your muscle in the toe, actually have to be intact so that they make contact with the muscle. And in ALS, they actually start to fall apart, they degenerate, so that there is no connection anymore between the nerve and the muscle, and the muscle become paralyzed. Now, ALS is a disease that's usually occurring late in life. It's progressive, fatal, and almost incurable. And in more than 80-90% of cases, the cause is still enigmatic. But one thing that was sure, VEGF angiogenesis had never been implicated in ALS. Nevertheless, there are some very famous people, someone who talked also some years ago here, Stephen Hawking, but Mao Zedong, Dmitri Shostakovich, and Lou Gehrig, they all died of or have ALS or died of ALS. Now, how does VEGF actually protect neurons? Well, we think that if you have low VEGF levels, for all the reasons that I told you and explained you, your vessels are impaired and perfusion will be impaired. And so also there is insufficient oxygen delivery, and so these neurons are continuously suffering some stress. In addition, we have other experiments that VEGF directly is important for protection of neurons, irrespective of the vascular effects. So are there then any therapeutic implications? Yes, there are. We consider that if you remove VEGF, you cause or you aggravate ALS, so let's give VEGF back and then see whether we can improve ALS. So we designed an osmotic pump so that we gave actually recombinant VEGF inside into the brain. And lo and behold, what we noticed is that, that you can see that when you treat then mice, ALS rats in this case, with VEGF, recombinant VEGF, that they will stay on longer on the rotor rod than the ones that received control. So overall, what we're now doing is together with Professor Wim Rombrecht, who is the vice rector of the biomedical group at the time, we're testing whether VEGF treatment actually is effective in ALS patients. Oh, I'm sorry. The movie doesn't play on my screen, that's why I'm confused. So what happens in ALS is that there are, in the normal healthy patients, there are signals, electrical signals, that are delivered to the neurons, to the nerves in the spinal cord, and then further on, actually, to the muscle, for instance, of your small toe, and that's why you can move your small toe. And what happens in ALS is that, in particular, that part, the nerves of the coming from the spinal cord, are falling apart, they're degenerating, and that causes paralysis of the muscle. So we thought, and we have tested in animal models, that if you give back VEGF, then maybe you can revert or halt that process of neurodegeneration, as you can see it here. And this is shown in a second. So we've given VEGF as a protein back, also as gene therapy back, and have noticed that this actually improves and provides neuroprotection of the neurons, so the nerve cells behave better, and also it improves perfusion. So, talking about breaking boundaries, there was not a single study linking VEGF to ALS in neurodegeneration. This was actually an accidental discovery. There was no expertise at the time in the lab. There was also no funding for this particular project. I had to convert the lab to a neuroscience lab for part at least. And after we submitted the paper was rejected. But it was rejected in a big way. in a way that the referees even wrote this paper should not be published at all. So this was clearly, again, one of those moments. So we reviewed the papers we worked on it for 2 years. The paper was reviewed by 8 reviewers, and finally, the 8th reviewer told the editor, get rid of the 4th referee, and then the paper was finally published. So we created a new opening onto a field of neurovascular link, and now VEGF therapy is being tested in ALS patients. So, fourth lesson, being curious and persistent paid off. So I've shown you some examples on how the neurovascular link actually can be important for health and disease. The neurovascular link that was originally discovered by Andreas Vesalius. But what actually happened with Andreas Vesalius after he published his book? Well, curiously enough, he quitted science and he did not do any research anymore, and he became physician of the court of Charles, the Emperor Charles. And on one of his trips, in particular on a trip when he was on return from Jerusalem, he strands on an island close to Turkey, becomes ill, and dies. So one of the greatest giants in medical history dies in complete isolation without any funeral at all. But his legacy, which changed the face of medicine forever, lives on. So if I may preach a little bit at the end of my presentation, I would say to all the young students in the audience, dare to break boundaries, think, be, and act like Vesalius, and believe what another great scientist ever wrote, Albert Einstein. Most people think or say that it is the intellect which makes a great scientist. They're wrong. It's character. And to the institutions, the research institutions, create an environment where a new young Vesalius can stand up. I would like to acknowledge then all the funding agencies, all lab members, previous and current, and collaborators, mentors, family, and key opinion leaders, the KU Leuven, VIB, as well as companies for the freedom to explore. Vivitur ingenio, caeteris mortus erunt. Thank you for your attention.